this place again with your song. Flood our thoughts with wonder and awe. Give us a greater glimpse of an ever-changing God. All we want and all we
Calvary, and welcome to Sanctuary. I'm Pastor Brian Fergus, and I am so glad that we are together again here in the Mission Bible Institute Library. We're going to continue our time of studying God's Word. We've had some worship. Now it's time to open God's Word together, and I'm ready to jump into that right away. So we should pray and get on with it. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for this time and the opportunity you've given us to gather online as a faith community, just devoted to you, to worshiping you, and to showing people what you're really like. Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to open up your word, to discover what it has to say for our lives today. I would ask that you would bless this time, that you would use it to encourage and strengthen our faith. In Jesus' name, amen. You know me. And you know that I like to begin our conversations with a question to get you thinking in the right direction. And so today's question is, maybe pretty deep would be a way to describe it. Here goes. what are you supposed to be doing with your life? I know that's kind of a big question to consider on a weekday especially, but it's a loaded question, isn't it? That gets to the heart of what you think your life's purpose is. We all ask defining questions at different points in our lives. You know, those big defining questions are, who am I? Why am I here? And maybe you've never really had an opportunity to ponder those, but in the back of your mind, they swirl around and you wonder why you're doing what you're doing. Why do you get up every day and go to a job that you kind of like? You know, why are you doing what you're doing? You see, without an understanding of our purpose, we just stumble through our days without really knowing where we're going. And at the end of the journey, we've wasted them. It was Socrates who said, "The unexamined life is not worth living." And I think he's right. I think we have to think about why we're here so we don't just spend our days killing time, you know, getting to the end of our lives and thinking, wow, that went quick. I wish I'd have done this or that or the other thing. Now, why is it so important to be aware of our life's purpose? Because having a sense of purpose gives life meaning. And it also enables us to endure the tough times. Viktor Frankl really understood the power of knowing your life's purpose. Have you ever heard of Viktor Frankl? Frankl was an Austrian psychiatrist and a Jew when Hitler started sending Jewish people to death camps. Frankl ended up at several of these concentration camps, including Auschwitz. And what a horrible thing to have to endure in life. And so despair overcame Frankl. He talks about just the hopelessness that he lived with until one day, in the midst of all of this suffering and starvation and mistreatment, he had kind of an epiphany, if you will. He reminded himself of his purpose in life. Like I said, he was a psychiatrist. He believed that his purpose was to help people understand and overcome the trauma and tragedy they experienced in life. And so he lived out that purpose, even in the darkest days of spending time in a Nazi concentration camp. Here's what he did. Frankl framed his experience, especially at Auschwitz, as an experiment. He began viewing this experience as an opportunity to really understand the human mind under pressure. And not only was he paying attention to his own well-being, but he was also looking at, you know, the other prisoners around him. The crazy thing is, he decided he would start keeping a journal, which is really hard to do in a concentration camp, I would imagine, right? And so he would find little scraps of paper and make notes, even little scraps of cloth, and he would hide them away. Fortunately, he survived the experience and was able to take all of those little notes that he had made with him. He wrote a book entitled Man's Search for Meaning, which is an amazing book. I highly recommend that you spend some time reading it. It's a good book. But among other things in this book, Frankl concluded that an awareness of one's life purpose really helps us endure and excel no matter what is going on around us. I know that clinging to my personal life purpose has really helped me stay the course, if you will, during this global pandemic that we're still in the midst of. So my question for you then, is this, what is your purpose? It's a question I asked you a few moments ago, but let's zero in on it. What are you supposed to be doing with your days on this planet? Can I help maybe direct your thinking on that question a little bit? I mean, I want you to answer it, but I want you to be aware of a few things as you wrap your mind around your answer. One of the things that I'd like to remind you is this. Christian, when you pledged allegiance to Jesus, when you put your faith and trust in him and gave your heart to him, your life's purpose got saved right along with your soul. Your life's purpose is now wrapped up in what Jesus is determined to accomplish in human history. In fact, in addition to maybe your specific purpose, Jesus gave you a grand purpose to pursue. What is that purpose that Jesus gave you? There's no need to keep you in suspense on this one. We'll just get to the answer and then we'll unpack it as we open up God's word today. But the bottom line of the life purpose for every Christian is this. Your purpose is to show people what God is really like and to encourage your brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to say that again because I don't want you to miss it. Your life purpose, in addition to the specific things that you feel called to do, your grand scheme, big picture life purpose is to show other people what God is really like and to encourage your brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, and that's a big purpose, right? That's a grand task. How are we supposed to accomplish that purpose? How are we supposed to pull that off? I mean, how are we, just us human beings, supposed to show people what God is really like and encourage our brothers and sisters in Christ? What do we bring to the table that could make that happen? What could we possibly have to offer others that would help them? And in addition to that, how could we advance God's purposes? Because when you look at this grand life purpose, it all seems a little bit beyond us as individuals, doesn't it? Well, I have some very good news for you today. Another thing that I want you to understand is this. God never asks us to show people what he is really like and to encourage our brothers and sisters in Christ in and of our own strength. He doesn't call us to do all of that on our own. He simply wants us to partner with the Holy Spirit to live out the life purpose that he has given us. Now, you know, we've been talking about the Holy Spirit for a few weeks now, and today we're continuing our study that we've called God in Us, the Holy Spirit. We've been looking at the roles that the Holy Spirit plays in our lives as followers of Jesus, and we've seen a few things already. We've seen that the Holy Spirit dwells within us and that he helps us in some very significant ways. We've seen that he helps us understand the truth that God has revealed to us in his word. We've also seen that the Holy Spirit even helps us pray. The bottom line is that the Holy Spirit is our partner on this journey with Jesus. And today I want us to explore another way the Holy Spirit partners with us to help us live well. And here's that ministry. The Holy Spirit empowers us to live on purpose. The Holy Spirit empowers us. Let's remember that as we move forward. As I said, God has given us this grand purpose. He wants us to show and tell people what he's really like. He wants us to encourage and build up and lift up our brothers and sisters in the Lord. And God always intended that we would do that in partnership with the Holy Spirit. I'm struck, and I want you to think about this with me for just a moment. It's a little rabbit trail, but not much of one. I've always been struck by how much the Holy Spirit wants to partner with God's people to accomplish God's purposes. I mean, take scripture, for example. The Holy Spirit partnered with human authors to reveal God's truth to us. He did that through his ministry of inspiration. That was a specific ministry he did for the apostles and prophets as they wrote the books that are contained in our Bible. And in a similar way, not exactly the same way, but in a similar way, he wants to partner with us to show people what God is like and to encourage his church, our spiritual family. So how does the Holy Spirit partner with us to accomplish that life's purpose? We saw that he had partnered with the apostles and prophets through his ministry of inspiration. How does he partner with us to fulfill this grand purpose that is all wrapped up in what Jesus has determined to do in human history? Well, the Apostle Peter is going to tell us in the passage of Scripture we're going to look at together today that the Holy Spirit empowers us to live on purpose by giving us a spiritual gift. The Holy Spirit partners with us to be a part of what Jesus is doing in this world by giving his followers spiritual gifts. I want you to do me a favor and open up your Bible with me to 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. That's where we're going to camp today. So open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 4. I'll give you a moment to do that. While you're finding 1 Peter in your New Testament, let me remind you a few things about who it actually was that who wrote this. The Apostle Peter, who tells us toward the end of his letter that he wrote it with the help of his friend Silas, the Apostle Peter was one of Jesus's three closest friends, right? This is the first gospel preacher, if you will, on the day of Pentecost. He knew Jesus well for the duration of Jesus's earthly ministry. He was one of the three who witnessed the transfiguration. This was somebody who knew Jesus, understood Jesus, and had experienced the grace of Jesus, right? Peter had been forgiven for denying the Lord. I don't think he ever forgot that. Not as a moment of regret. Maybe there's a little regret, but as a moment of Jesus' grace, as Jesus accepts him back into his fold there at the end of the Gospel of John. Peter, this Peter, who was a fisherman by trade, living kind of in a backwater town on the coast of the Sea of Galilee, becomes this mighty leader in Jesus's church. And he knows that it's not just him doing that work, that actually the Holy Spirit is working through him. And so he tells the people that he writes this letter to that every Christian, every follower of Jesus has been given a spiritual gift. And that's what he's writing about in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. He says this, got to find the right page in my Bible. I have it on 5:10. That wouldn't help me right now. 1 Peter 4:10 says this, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Among other things, in this passage, the Apostle Peter tells us that every believer has been given a spiritual gift. Did you see that in this passage? At the top of verse 10 there, he says, as each has received a gift. And he's talking to Christians scattered throughout Asia Minor here, and he's talking to each of them. Each of you Christians has been given a gift. He's talking about these spiritual gifts. We each have some useful gifting that we've received from the Holy Spirit that enables us to fulfill our life's purpose as a part of God's family. These gifts from the Holy Spirit are abilities. Abilities for ministry, talents, if you will. Spiritual talents that the Holy Spirit gives us that we wouldn't have otherwise. And Peter gives us some examples here, doesn't he, in this passage, verse 11, whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies. In big categories, if you're doing out front kind of ministry for the Lord, or if you're in the background of things, making ministry happen, you're doing so because the Holy Spirit has uniquely gifted you to do that. Now, this isn't the only passage in the New Testament that talks about spiritual gifts. They're scattered throughout the New Testament. Let me just take you to one. Keep your spot there in 1 Peter chapter 4 and turn to Romans chapter 12 with me. In Romans 12, Paul is going to give us a list of spiritual gifts. And he does that in Romans chapter 12, starting with verse 4. He says this, "For as in one body we have many members," he's talking about our body parts, "and the members do not all have the same function." He uses this analogy before: our ears don't do the same thing that our eyes do. "So we, Christians, though many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another." So he's likening how our human body works to how the body of Christ, one of his favorite analogies, functions as well. And then look what he says, verse 6, "having gifts," these are spiritual gifts, "that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them." Sounds like Peter there. "If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation." That means like encouragement. "The one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness," right? And so there are several gifts listed here in Romans chapter 12, prophecy, service, teaching, giving, leading, and a few others. We get another list of spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And I won't take us to that list because I don't want us to get too deep into the weeds of specific spiritual gifts today. I mean, we could spend weeks just talking about what each of these gifts is and what they mean. That's not the point that I'm trying to communicate to you today. The point that I'm trying to communicate is simply this. When God saved you, he examined your life, your personality, your education, your desires, and based upon who you are, he gave you a spiritual gift. And the Holy Spirit uses that gift to show and tell people what God is really like when you partner with him in exercising that gift. The Holy Spirit also partners with us to use that gift to encourage our brothers and sisters in Christ. So there's no doubt about it. You have a spiritual gift that helps you fulfill your life's purpose. Because one of the ministries of the Holy Spirit is that he empowers us. The Holy Spirit empowers us. Now, the question that people always have when we have a discussion about spiritual gifts is, how can I tell what my spiritual gift actually is? Which is a great question. There's several ways to do that, and I'll get to some of them in a moment. But first, let me just clear something up for you. I don't want you to think for one second that the Holy Spirit is trying to make your search for your spiritual gift a mystery or something difficult. It's not like he wants to keep that knowledge from you. He's trying to be very apparent with that knowledge so that you can use the gift that he has already given you. So what are some ways to figure out what your spiritual gift is? Some people use spiritual gifts analysis tests. You can find those online now, and they're helpful to an extent. But when those first started coming out, I remember asking myself, how did people figure out their spiritual gifts before we had these tests? Like in New Testament times, how did people figure out what their spiritual gifts were? Well, like I said, the Holy Spirit knows you intimately. He dwells within you. Probably knows you better than you know you. And so when he gifted you, he certainly did so. He certainly gave you a gift that was suited to who you are. And so I think figuring out what our spiritual gift is just as simple as asking a few questions. Here's one that you might entertain. What are you good at? Managing? Are you good at working with kids? Helping others in times of crisis? Getting in the trenches and really ministering to folks? Are you good at speaking in front of people, because the Holy Spirit is going to work in your life in that way. Not only what do you think you're good at, what do other people tell you you're good at? Right? Because just because we think we're good at something might not necessarily be a reflection of reality. We might just think we're good at it. But what do other people affirm you in? Man, when you gave that Bible study, it was fantastic. Or I really appreciated that card you sent me, that card of encouragement. So these are just questions to ask to try to figure out what your spiritual gift is. Here's another one. What do you like to do? What do you like to do? Because if the Holy Spirit has given you a spiritual gift, he's certainly also implanted the desire to use it in you. And so thinking about what we like to do is an indicator as well. And this is my favorite question to ask people as I'm helping them figure out what their spiritual gift is, because it always throws everybody off. What do you do that feels like play? Let me explain. When we are operating in our spiritual gift, chances are pretty good that we're really enjoying ourselves, right? And so when, what do you do when you do this thing, you don't even notice the passage of time, or you're bummed when it's over because it seemed to go too fast? What do you do that just feels like play? Personal testimony time. For me, it's teaching. I absolutely love to teach. Now, I'm not saying it's not work, because putting all of these messages together and stuff is work. But when I'm actually teaching, like right now, I am having such a good time. In fact, people at Calvary Phoenix always ask me, Pastor Brian, you're always laughing and smiling when you're teaching. What's going on? And I just tell them, I'm enjoying myself. This is fun for me. And that is one of the ways that I know that I'm operating in my spiritual gift. And so what do you enjoy doing? What feels like play? These are the kinds of questions to ask yourself. And once you know what your spiritual gift is, then your responsibility is to use it, right? You can't just sit back and do nothing with it. In fact, we're called by God to be good stewards of the gift that he gave it us. We see that in this passage. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. We're told to use our gifts. We shouldn't sit back and just do nothing with them, because that's not why the Holy Spirit gave them to us. He gave them to us so that we could show and tell people what God is really like, so that we could lift up our brothers and sisters in Christ. Getting a gift and not using it, that's like getting a new tool or getting a new Christmas present or something like that, and just kind of sticking it in the closet and never doing anything with it. We're told, like I said, in this passage, to be good stewards of the gift that God has given us. That means that we're to use our spiritual gifts, these abilities given to us by the Holy Spirit, to the best of our abilities, in a balanced and thoughtful way. And so when we think about using our spiritual gifts, it's also important to ask, you know, where will my spiritual gift do the most good? That's stewarding properly. And then we use it there, because the Holy Spirit empowers us, right? This is one of the ministries or roles he performs in our lives. He wants us to use the gifts that he has given us. And using our gifts enables us to fulfill our part in God's grand scheme. Using our gifts enables us to fulfill our life's purpose. Peter tells us that when we're using our gifts as the Spirit intended, two things will happen. God will be glorified. Did you catch that at the end of verse 11? Whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that, so that, in everything, God may be glorified. And when we say that God may be glorified, that means that people will actually see what God is really like through us, through our exercise of our gifts. And not only that, when we exercise our gifts, we'll be serving one another. We see that at the beginning of verse 10. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. When he uses one another language, he's talking about our brothers and sisters in Christ. And so that's why I keep saying that when we are using our spiritual gift, we are fulfilling God's purpose in our lives. And that purpose is to show others what God is really like and to build up and serve our brothers and sisters in Christ. And when we do that, we're living on purpose for God, right? And so my encouragement to you today is really very simple. First, take time to think about what your spiritual gift is. Take time to explore it, discover it. Talk to your good friends in the Lord about it. And come to terms with what it is that God has uniquely equipped you to do. Second, once you've figured out what your spiritual gift is, use your spiritual gift to show people what he's like and to serve your brothers and sisters in Christ, because that's what we're supposed to be doing with our days. Let's live on purpose for the Lord. Amen? The Holy Spirit empowers us to do that. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for the revealed truth of your word. We thank you for this passage in Peter and the other passages that we've looked at today that help us understand you've given us gifts. Holy Spirit, you have a unique ministry in our lives of empowering us to serve you well and serve you boldly for the glory of God and the building up of the body of Christ. We thank you for that gift. Lord, if some folks are struggling with what that gift is that you've given them, would you please give them wisdom and insight? Either through just, you know, direct interaction with them or through the interaction of other faithful Christians in their lives. Help them know what it is that you have gifted them with so they can serve you boldly. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time. We humbly come to you requesting these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, thanks for being a part of this study today. We really appreciate you continuing to be involved in our ministry here at Calvary Phoenix in these, you know, different times that we're living in now. I'd ask that you would continue to pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ. Continue to financially support our ministry here so that we can do our part in advancing God's kingdom purposes in our valley and in our world. We love you. We'll see you next week. God bless you.